For the next 6 weeks, I'm going to preach on a psalm that has really taken hold in my own heart and borne some great fruit as of late. I was given a book by a friend on the 23rd psalm as I prepared to leave on my trip when I left at the end of November. And it was just a little small book. It was about 173 pages. So I thought I would kind of pop it out on my flight to Dublin and catch some sleep for the rest of the flight. And little did I know what God had for me in this little gem of the 23rd psalm. I spent the rest of the trip in this little book, and I had flights and train rides and all kinds of things, and it was just ministering so deep to a weary soul that I spent so much time in prayer and meditation that it actually took me 25 hours to get through this little book. I think the peak was when I was flying home, a 10-hour flight. God gave me my own row of seats, and there was just no one around me, just me and the Lord and this book. And it was 10 hours of uninterrupted fellowship with the Lord. I've never not dozed off in a plane in my life. And I'm telling you, just 10 hours of just uninterrupted fellowship with God. It was like there was no one else on that airplane but me and the Lord. And I can't begin to tell you the way he ministered to my soul. He is the good shepherd. He restored my soul. He brought me to still waters to drink and drink and drink up his presence in his word, and it tasted to me like living water, and it was just so satisfying to my soul. All of my thirsts were completely satisfied. They were quenched, and I knew that I had to share it with you all. Something this good, you just can't keep it to yourself. So for the next 6 weeks, I want to bring you to the good shepherd and just let you drink and drink and drink and really be satisfied with him alone, to where your soul will cry out, I shall not want. In the land of plenty, I want us to be a people who I shall not want. The Lord is my shepherd. We have everything, and I just want to be looking at the fullness of that for the next few weeks. So let's go into it together, and this is going to be a beautiful season, I believe, in the Word of God, and I want it to be worship. I want it to be in spirit and in truth. This psalm is what happens when a soul completely trusts God. So beautiful. I have a dear brother in Christ who's been a great friend, and he's actually been writing a devotional on the Psalms, and he's drank so deeply from this psalm that I just asked him, would you start our little series here and just come up and pray? So if you would come up here. This is my dear friend Rick Hallahan, and he's just going to bring us to the throne of grace and ask God's blessing as we behold Psalm 23. Rick?
Pray. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me lie in green pastures. He leads me by still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. You prepare my table in the midst of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Father, we all need this song desperately. We know that you are our good shepherd. But sometimes, Father, we don't really cling to that. We don't live in light of that. Oh God, please, over the next weeks, that our under-shepherd preaches on behalf of the true shepherd, that these truths will come and they will grip our hearts, our minds, our souls. There are many here this morning that need the good shepherd because they are hurting and they need the oil of comfort. There are many here that are complacent and they need to be chastened with the rod. There are many here that need forgiveness, and there are many here that need to be forgiven. The psalm covers every emotion, every state of human existence. And so we can all come here for the next weeks and come and just drink from the fountain of this psalm, from the voice of our pastor. Oh God, bless him. Prepare his heart. Use him to give us the food that we need to live the Christian life. and to trust you with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength. Father, we love you so much. We love the Good Shepherd. And if there's any here this morning, Father, that doesn't have that shepherd, they need him desperately. They need a shepherd. None of us can do it on our own. We're weak. We're sinful. We're dumb. Like sheep, we need you. God, please use this series of messages out of this most delightful song. Draw many souls to Jesus Christ. And for those of us that know the shepherd, may through these messages, may we know him more deeply and more intimately. Thank you again for your holy word. We know that every word spoken from this psalm is from the very breath of God. We thank you and we praise you. And now we commit our pastor into your hands. We ask in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you.
The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures, and he leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul, and he guides me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou dost prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou hast anointed my head with oil, and my cup overflows. Surely goodness and loving kindness will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. What a psalm. I've entitled it, The Soul That Wants for Nothing. Shalom. This is probably the most beloved psalm throughout church history to many, and it's most likely the best loved psalm and the best known. Charles Spurgeon called it the pearl of the psalms. It's been used to comfort many souls. It's dried many eyes. It's brought joy to a great multitude. McLaren has said it has supplied the mold into which many hearts have poured their peaceful faith into. Millions have memorized it. I'm going to encourage you as well. If we're only doing a verse a week, I don't believe there's anyone in here who can't do that. So let's memorize it together as we go through it. Ministers have used it to comfort many. For some, the words of this psalm have been the last ones that were uttered in their life. This is truly one of the psalms for the living. And so as we begin to look at this masterpiece, I just want to begin with a few observations of the general psalm, and then we'll begin to look at the detailed elements. First, I think this psalm is itself green pastures, its still waters, and its paths of righteousness. And so I'm going to invite you to come lie down in it and drink in it and be comforted. Let it minister to your soul each week. Let it restore your soul if you're under great trial or duress, affliction, depression, drought, whatever it may be. I want it to restore your soul because it has that in it. Let it do its work on your soul during this season. And I'm praying and asking God that he will do to your soul what he did for me on those plains. But you are going to have to fight for some quiet time. The enemy's ploy in us is to keep us so busy and to keep everything loud. I need you to fight for some quiet time. Fight to get alone and think on these things and meditate and pray over them and just turn them around. How will this affect the way I think and live my day-to-day life? So I need you to kind of fight for some quiet time in the midst of all the chaos that we live in. So this is a psalm that the content needs to be sown into your soul. To give time and attention and be deliberate and just get alone with the good shepherd. It is so personal. In worship, it was to give you a personal, authentic experience of God. And so I pray, let it be your song before we finish this series. Secondly, I just want to make some observations about the structure of this psalm. In verses 1 through 3, you see again and again, he makes me lie down, he leads me, he restores me, he guides me. And then in verses 4 through 6, there's kind of this switch to you and thou, thy rod, thou dost prepare, thou hast anointed. And so there's kind of change from he to you or thou. And so just wrestling with that, I think it's not good to speak long about God with theology without speaking to him. And so theologians, we need them. They're beautiful gifts to the church so that we can understand God, and they help us put it into words and thoughts as we try to behold what God has revealed in the scriptures. And so they're a great gift to the church. And what I've said is more, all of us should be striving to be theologians, that we're seeking to know and understand God and his word deeper and better. So study it, understand, have a knowledge of him and his ways. But in Psalm 23, theology now moves into prayer. He's talking about God, and right in the middle, he switches to start talking to God. So here's what he does. Here's theology. Here's my God. Oh, God, I start praying and pleading and talking to you. So an example is God is glorious. And then, oh, how I adore your glory, God. And that seems to be what the psalmist is doing and moving in this psalm. Theology must always lead to doxology. The truth of God must always lead us to worship, to praise, to praying to God. It must lead us there. And so has it led your heart to that? That will be the question of Psalm 23. Does it get jammed up with just knowing? There are people, I know it, who are sitting here right now and it gets jammed up. All of your theology and what you're learning, it's just jammed up and not moving in to what we're going to see in Psalm 23. So let this psalm lead you to doxology during this series. Don't just stay in the theology of this psalm. I pray that it would lead you personally into worship. I want you to fight for that during our time together. Thirdly, excuse me, one last thought. Why does David switch then from he to you? And when he does it in verse 4. He says, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. And so while you're walking through the valley of the shadow of death, we're to fear no evil. The crisis that comes in our lives, the urgent things, the dangerous things, the hard things that come upon us. Some of you I know right now are sitting in a valley. We had 4 people taken to emergency rooms or hospitals just this week. So there's valleys all around us. You're fighting, you're in them. Well, what happens in valleys? In valleys, we draw near to God. In dark ravines, we cry out more than in green pastures. When I'm in a green pasture, it's not as much as when I'm in a valley. I need God more, and I pray more, and I seek him all the more. In life and death situations, theological sentence and thoughts turn to our cry to God for help in the deep valleys. And so here it is, it turns and it transitions in the hardness of life, where now I talk about God and I'm crying to God. I need him. If we don't have shadows in the valley of death, we'll start to love the green grass more than the shepherd who led us there and gave it to us. So true life has to have valleys. It has to learn that thou art with me in these times, that God is better than life, even in this. So every life has to have valleys by the Good Shepherd's design. And I don't want you saying, why am I in this? How could God do this? This is the love of a Good Shepherd, and he brings you into these, and it's where it transitions from theology to crying to God, and that he is with me in the journey that I'm walking right now. Another one last thought. It kind of ties in. Why would a good shepherd, lead you then to a path that's in the valley of the shadow of death? Why would a good shepherd do that? And some of you could be asking that in your heart this morning. Why would he do this? I don't understand. The shepherd would lead his sheep to places to get them to green pastures, to get them to still waters, to restore a soul. So for the shepherd to get us to the very best places of himself, sometimes he's got to take us through the valley. John Piper said he never dunks you just to make you miserable, but so that you will come up and behold more of his glory. And so he will never lead you into these paths for just to hurt you, just to make it difficult. It will be so you will behold more of his glory and more of his face. And so I do. I pray that everyone in this room gets this. It's not to make you miserable. It's not to just scare you, but it's to lead you to the place of blessing. And you cannot get to greater blessing without the valley and the shadow of death. To feed on him, the green grass, to drink the still water, the living water, you have got to go into the valleys. And we're going to spend a whole week just on that concept. But out of the gate, I want you just to have that nugget to begin chewing on, because I think a lot of us need it right now. And then one last quick thought. This one's really quick. I want to give special thanks to a man by the name of W. Philip Keller. That was the book that was given to me on that flight, and God used it so mightily in my life to open up this psalm that I'm going to use much of what he taught me, and I just want to give him credit. I'll try to give him direct quotes, but just a lot of it now is in my head, and it's just going to flow out. And so I just want to thank God for that man and let you know how much he has influenced my thinking. So are you ready? Are you ready? Did you know it was Psalm 23? I was all excited to surprise you, and someone gave it away early in the introduction. So Psalm 23, this is my Christmas present. I love it. I hope you're excited with me. Have you ever went and just seen like an amazing sight? Like I went to see the Grand Canyon, and then the joy that you have when you get to bring someone else to see it. You know how satisfying that is? This is weird. When I go to a great restaurant, the first thing I think of is, who can I bring here? And when I bring them, it brings me joy to watch them stuffing their face and loving it the way I did. And so it's strange, but I feel that way this morning, as I have just tasted of something so sweet that I can't wait for you to eat it with me. And I'm excited for what we're going to do in the weeks ahead. So let's pray one more time, and we will open up Psalm 23. Father, I pray that we would not just know Psalm 23, but we would know the shepherd of Psalm 23, God. I just pray for every heart. Lord, there's so many burdens and so many wanderings and things that we were desiring and things that we're wanting. The very heart of sin is desiring. And Lord, I thank you that the realities of what we're going to look at here can heal all of those things. God, I just want every hurting heart to just come and see a good shepherd who gives them everything that they need. Lord, that they don't have to want when he's their shepherd. And so, Lord, I just pray now, I'm just looking to your Holy Spirit to do what a man cannot do. God, would you, by your Spirit, minister these words to every heart, mind, and soul here. Let no one walk out of here without beholding the reality. The Lord is my shepherd. God, pour out your Spirit through the Word of God this morning. We pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. I'm going to give you my outline. In verse 1, this is kind of the foundational statement of the whole psalm. So we'll focus on that for a couple weeks. If you understand that, the rest of the psalm will just unfold quite naturally. In verses 2 through 3, he's going to show us then the shepherd's provision. And then in verses 4 through 5, we're going to look at the shepherd's protection with his rod and his staff. And then in verse 6, he's going to show us that we have the shepherd's presence. I will dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life. And so I have the shepherd's provision, the shepherd's protection, and the shepherd's presence. And that'll be what's overwhelming David. David is the one who penned this psalm. And so it starts in verse 1, that foundational statement. And then I want to spend some time and we'll look at the rest. But verse 1, again, the Lord is my shepherd. This is what's called an enphemene. And I struggle even saying it, enphemene. And it's a kind of a common Hebrew way of writing. And it was an argument that had 3 points. So the point was, you have a beginning, and then you have an end, and what's missing in the middle is implied. You imply it. So what we have here in this enphemene is, the Lord is my shepherd. And then something's implied, and he continues and says, I shall not want. And so what is implied in his argument here is that shepherds take care of all the needs of a flock 24/7. The Lord is my shepherd. Because of that, it's implied, I'm not going to want. I'm not going to be in need. And so what is implied is really our whole life. That is, it is implied that I'm in God's hand. I'm in the hand of providence. I'm in the hand of love. I'm in the hand of his conformity. I'm in the hand of his fullness. I'm in the hand of his joy. All of that is implied from the fact that the Lord is my shepherd. That's why I won't want. Amen? I got everything if he's my shepherd. So what is encompassed and the Lord is my shepherd is so beautiful and amazing and complete and full and satisfying that now my soul does not want. So we've got to understand what's implied to get to the fruit of my soul doesn't want because he's my shepherd. It's all taken care of by the fact that he is my shepherd. And so there has got to be something missing in our understanding or in our hearts about what it means that the Lord is my shepherd if I'm just full of unmet desires and wants. If all I am is a big ball of wants and desires and never happy and never satisfied, if that's all that my life is, there's something you're not understanding, something crucial that you're missing in the Christian life. And we're going to go after that. I'm going to spend a season trying to help you see all the fullness of what you have by being the Lord's sheep. And if you could behold that, all these problems and burdens and wanting things different could actually just fall off the table of your heart this morning. There's not anything that exists or ever will that is more blessed and satisfying than the fact that the Lord is my shepherd. Do you see that from our text? Let's try to figure out then what is implied in this amphetamine. Look with me. The Lord is my shepherd. I want to begin in verse 1. Who is the Lord? Who is the Lord? He's my shepherd. Can I trust him? What is he like? What is his character? Really, the question is he fit for such a task? Does he have the credentials to be my shepherd? So this has to be asked and it has to be answered for all of us. Because if I'm ever going to trust this God completely and without any kind of reservation, that's what he wants from every believer here this morning, to trust him completely and without any reservations. I need him to be more than the people that I've trusted in my life who have let me down again and again and again. Most of us could give a list and a line of people who have let us down. And I want to lift you out of that foolish place and come to the one who will never let you down. Who is my shepherd? Is this one sufficient to shepherd me to where I never want anything? This is better be an amazing answer for me to follow a shepherd unconditionally. And the answer is better than you could have ever hoped or believed. David says, the Lord. The Lord, it's in capital letters in every Bible, it should be. And that means Yahweh. Yahweh is my shepherd. That was the great Old Testament name for God. It was first disclosed to Moses in the burning bush in Exodus 3, where God's going to call him out to lead the people out of bondage. And there where God says, I am Yahweh. And then it's repeated, listen to this, more than 4,000 times in the Old Testament, that name. And the name literally means I am who I am. Chiefly, this name refers to God's timelessness and his self-sufficiency. The self-sufficiency is that he needs nothing. This shepherd is God. He needs no wisdom. He doesn't need power. He doesn't need help. He doesn't need to be served. He is completely self-sufficient. He's happy in who he is. He has everything that he needs. He answers only to himself. He truly is the only God. He's the unrivaled God of the universe. And his timelessness is that he is always the same in these eternal traits. He's a God who doesn't change. Every attribute is infinite, perfect. It doesn't grow and it doesn't diminish. He's sufficient. He's Yahweh. He's God. That is who my shepherd is. He was like this yesterday and he will be like this tomorrow. He is unchanged forever. He truly is the great I am. He is the object of David's trust. The Lord is your shepherd. And I pray this morning that you won't let that slip by easily. I meditated on this so long on that plane. There's so much here to go think about who your shepherd is. Don't just smile and walk away. The Lord, Yahweh, God, is your shepherd. You see, if you think too lowly of the Lord, you will be unwilling to allow him to have the full authority and absolute control of your lives. You'll always struggle with trusting and giving everything over to God if you don't comprehend this word, Yahweh. This is the key to the whole thing. It needs to be infinite. It needs to be big in your minds and in your hearts. The Lord Yahweh. Honestly, we will never give him outright ownership of our lives unless you get who this is. And so the fact of who our shepherd is the beauty and the key to our lives trusting him completely. Living satisfied lives, not wanting all of your days, really having that shalom that everyone's looking for, that peace, that wellness, that wholeness. So please don't pass by this quickly. The Lord is my shepherd. That name, that person is none other than Almighty God. That's who's shepherding me. I just sat there looking out my office window at the hills and the mountains and the trees and the skies and just acknowledging the creator of that, Yahweh, is my shepherd. Doesn't that take your breath away just a little bit? Doesn't that fix problems real quickly? Yahweh is your shepherd. That one who all the worlds and the universes bow to, and every little organism and microbe submits to him, that one is my shepherd. Amen? Oh, I pray we get that. That can change so much. Get alone with God. Just dwell on Yahweh. And so let's look then at the second point. Yahweh is my shepherd. On the other side of the statement, you got Yahweh and you got shepherd, which is truly an amazing choice of words. Because a shepherd in Israel, there weren't people fighting for that job. It was just the lowest of all the works that you could do. I've told you before, they couldn't even testify in court because they were scoundrels. And just think about it. All you do is live with sheep all day long, 24 hours a day, caring for them, nurturing them, sleeping out in the fields, protecting them. Day and night, summer and winter, the task of caring for them is unending. I don't think there's ever been an animal more needy than a sheep. And so if a family needed a shepherd, who would you pick? You pick the youngest. I'm not going to do it. I'm not going to do it. And you end up with the youngest person in the family shepherding the flock. And so that was true of David. When they come to look for a king, they go through all the sons and there's one missing, the youngest. Where is he? He's out shepherding the sheep. And so here's David, a shepherd. And he gets this analogy then so well as he writes this psalm. And so the question was, who in their right mind would be a shepherd? Yet Yahweh has chosen to be our shepherd, which is very common in the day for the kings were sometimes called shepherds because they would watch over and they would protect and they would represent God and his character to the people. And so that's a bad king represented a bad thing. And so a shepherd is so beautiful and powerful. Yahweh has chosen to be our shepherd. The great I am, the great God of the universe, the one who spoke it into being, has stooped to take us sheep, who Isaiah says have all gone astray. We've turned to our own ways away from him. We hate him. We despise him. We're going the other direction. And he comes and says, oh, I'm going to be a shepherd and I'm going to care for my sheep. So right out of the gate, this is telling us something magnificent, isn't it? The Lord is my shepherd. It shows there's something more going on in this universe than just a God who is majestic and transcendent. We see it as we look out. We all know it. But there's something bigger. He created people. There's just such a chasm between God and created mankind. But this statement should take your breath away. All of a sudden, the creator of all of it, the Lord, Yahweh, is my shepherd. My shepherd? Doesn't that just kind of proclaim kind of a working relationship now? It isn't just us distant from God. All of a sudden, there brings in this realm of relationship, and there's a shepherd with sheep, with the creation and God. There's something deep and rich going on between God and man. It's now shepherd and sheep. The psalm just takes common clay of mankind and it's moved into divine destiny, and God is now making it for honorable use. You are something more than just a lump of clay now, just a mass of humanity and mankind. You're brought into a realm with God now and Him being your shepherd. He's taking it and He's bringing you into relationship. This is really, really special what David is beholding. A now created human is now the cherished object, as Keller said, of divine diligence. You are now the object of divine diligence. He looks at you, sheep, and He says, I'm giving everything that I am now to be a shepherd to you, to bring you home to the fold called eternal glory. And so you are now an object of divine diligence by Yahweh as a shepherd over you, sheep, here this morning. I'm not just a speck in this vast universe any longer. Sometimes I just feel like a number and I'm walking through the motions with a bunch of purposeless human beings. And this does something amazing this morning. It opens up the soul to what every human being has always been looking for. You've been made by God and you were made for God, and every soul is looking for its creator. We know that we were made for Him, and we'll never be happy till we are back with Him. We won't be right or sound until we are in a relationship with God. So in this psalm, we become the cherished object of divine diligence. He loves us. We are His sheep. And the shepherd lays down His life for the sheep. I am now the object of His purpose and His plan and His care. Yahweh is now working for me as one of His sheep. He is shepherding me to His home far away where His glory forever I'll share. He is bringing me. And what did He say? He said, I lose none of my sheep. You're held by divine sovereignty as well. And this shepherd is guaranteeing that He will bring every sheep into this eternal fold called glory forever. I am the object of Yahweh's concern and His working for my good. Because of the gospel of Jesus Christ, God is now concerned about me as a person. I spent my whole unsaved life trying to find someone who loved me as much as I did. And now I have found the Lord who loves me more than any human love could have ever reached to. He's loved me eternally in Christ Jesus, where before the foundation of the world, He set His love upon me. The joy of who my shepherd is, the joy of just being His sheep. He's not a far-off God. He's near to me as a shepherd working for my good. And so these two words should never be used together unless God is a gracious, merciful, saving God. And so we have Lord Yahweh and shepherd of us as sheep. And it comes together in the gospel of Jesus Christ. And it's unbelievable what we have. Keller, in his book, he says, he was a shepherd himself. And he had a guy right next door to the ranch he had who was a terrible shepherd. And all the sheep were sick and weak. He said they would almost look at the fence. You could almost, if they could speak, saying, oh, I wish he was my shepherd. Because the grass was green, they were cared for. And he said they were just feeble and everything was just dying on that land. And he says you can tell a sheep's lot in life depended entirely on the type of man who owned it and who was their shepherd. So their whole lot depended on what their life would be like depended on the shepherd. If the shepherd was gentle and kind and selfless in his devotion, they were blessed sheep. But there were some who were cold, and they were what was called a day laborer, what Jesus called a hireling. And when the wolves would come, they would flee and run away because they had no investment in that flock. And so there were two kinds of shepherds. Under a good shepherd, the sheep would flourish and they would thrive contentedly. Under a bad shepherd, he said they would struggle and starve and just have endless hardship because the shepherd didn't care for the sheep. So if you have wandered in today and you're seeking and you've come in here and you're struggling, and I just want you to hear this, your shepherd as an unbeliever is someone called the devil. The devil is your shepherd. And I want you to hear, he doesn't care for you. The reason you're in the state that you're in today, depressed, discouraged, struggling, everything's going wrong that could go wrong, that is what is going on, is your shepherd doesn't care for you. He wants to destroy you. He wants to keep you away from God and have you end your life away from God and then suffer eternal torment. Your shepherd is a bad shepherd. I'm inviting you to a good shepherd this morning. Who your shepherd is would determine your lot in life and your destiny. And David is just sitting there marveling. I don't know where he wrote this. He's a shepherd. He's marveling, saying, my shepherd is the Lord. You just can't get a better shepherd. He will spend the rest of the psalm showing the beauty of what happens to you when this is the case. When you have a shepherd like this, wait till you see the way he treats his sheep and what he does to care for you. You can't use hyperbole when you talk of the blessing of being a sheep under the watchful care of the Lord. And so, Church of God, David tells us here, he's not just the God of big groups. This is not a community song, actually. It's highly individualized and it's highly personal. The Lord is my shepherd. I think the stunning part of that statement is the word my. We've looked at those big, beautiful words, God and a shepherd, and then there's this little pronoun, my. I pray that we would climb into that one little word and bask there all of our days. Can you say that as you sit here this morning, the Lord is my shepherd? It's not enough to say he's Pastor Murphy's shepherd. Every one of us have to say the Lord is my shepherd, or it'll do you no good at all. This is the gospel. This is assurance. This is where we got to live. Yahweh is my shepherd. He's not a shepherd. He's not the shepherd of all the people of the whole world. This song is about my shepherd. This psalm will do you no good until you can say my. All the beautiful things we're going to look at, you're going to be like this, you know, picture freezing outside on a snowy, blizzardy day, and you're going to freeze to death, and you find a little cabin. And you come up to the cabin and there's a fireplace in there and it looks so beautiful. And all you can do is sit on the outside and look in and think about how beautiful it'd be to sit next to that fireplace. And so you're going to hear all these beautiful things about the good shepherd and what he does. But until you can say the Lord is my shepherd, you're just sitting outside looking in at how beautiful it could be. So my prayer and my hope is that everyone in this room would be able to say the Lord is my shepherd. I'm his little ewe lamb, and he cares about me. If I were to wander off, he would leave the other 99, and he would go after me. We are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hands. Is this the one that you have placed all of your trust in here this morning? Are you trying to be your own shepherd? As a shepherd, I watch that nonstop. You're trying to be your own shepherd. You're trying to get yourself out of all your problems. You're trying to feed yourself. You're trying to get yourself to still waters. Everything you do is still about you. And you're your own shepherd, and you're trying to be God still in your own life. And so he's calling you to repent and come and bow your knee and surrender to the good shepherd. And now let him be your shepherd. He is the one. Surrender. You do that, I shall not want. Be your own shepherd, and you're going to want all the days of your life. You'll be beady, feeble-eyed sheep who never get it right. It'll be a miserable place. And so I pray that you would know the good shepherd, and that's how I'm going to close out this morning. How does he become my shepherd? Because I want everyone in this room to have that blessing and that joy. How does he become my shepherd? I want this relationship more than anything. To apply this as a New Testament saint, we have to put this then in the fullness of its setting, and it's beautiful, and we're going to set it there for the rest of our series. David knew God as a shepherd. Jacob is actually the first one in the Bible who said the Lord is his shepherd. He had already stated that. Joseph, when he was given blessing to Manasseh and Ephraim, they came in for the blessing, and he said, "The God who has been my shepherd all the days of my life." Joseph's life, I just love. Everything that went wrong, he went through the valley of the shadow of death many times. And he comes at the end where he finally can get even with those brothers. And he said, "You meant it for evil, but God meant it for good." And he means, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want." Moses was called to lead Israel out of bondage to Egypt. And he said he is to lead his people like a shepherd. Ezekiel speaks of the Lord as a shepherd. Now David, the shepherd boy, gets it as he sat there penning this. "The Lord is my shepherd." It's so beautiful, but history kept moving. And at the close of the Old Testament era, God is unhappy with the human shepherds that he has placed over his people. They were inwardly selfish, and they had exploited Israel on every turn. They were bad shepherds. And so God seeks to encourage his people in the midst of it. And he tells them there's a better day coming. There's a better shepherd coming. And amazingly, God tells Israel, this shepherd is going to be God himself. Yahweh will shepherd his people. In Ezekiel 34:15, he says, "I will feed my flock and I will lead them to rest," declares the Lord. Ezekiel 34:22, "Therefore I will deliver my flock and they will no longer be a prey, and I will judge between one sheep and another. And then I will set over them one shepherd, my servant David, and he will feed them, and he will feed them himself, and he will be their shepherd." So is it God or is it David who are going to shepherd his people? Well, when that was written, it'll be kind of tough for David since he's been dead for 400 years. So it isn't going to be King David. So it must mean someone from the line of David who will come and he will shepherd his flock. And the answer was what I preached on Christmas Eve, and I'm going to read it again because I love this passage of Scripture. Micah 5:2. "But as for you, Bethlehem Ephrathah, too little to be among the clans of Judah, from you one will go forth for me to be a ruler in Israel. His goings forth are from long ago, from the days of eternity, like God. Therefore he will give them up until the time when she who is in labor has borne a child. And then the remainder of his brethren will return to the sons of Israel. And he will arise and he will shepherd his flock in the strength of the Lord and in the majesty of the name of the Lord his God. And they will remain because at that time he will be great to the very ends of the earth." And so God will come. David will come. The shepherd will be from Bethlehem. And the shepherd will be the Ancient of Days. So he will be Davidic and he will be divine. And I want you to hear what Paul wrote when he began his gospel. He said, "This gospel concerning his son, who was born of a descendant of David according to the flesh, and who was declared the Son of God with power by the resurrection from the dead, according to the Spirit of holiness, Jesus Christ, our Lord." He was born of a virgin. He was the Son of God, and he walked this earth. And there was a day when he was walking this earth that was recorded for us by the Apostle John. And he stands up among all the people, and he says, "I am Yahweh. I am the Good Shepherd." And the Good Shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. Do you realize what Jesus said that day? "I am," remember that Yahweh, Jesus Christ, "I am Yahweh come in the flesh." He is the good shepherd that God promised for his flock. He was Davidic and he was divine. He was born in Bethlehem and he has come and he has secured your salvation and your provision and your protection by laying down his life for you as he went up on a cross and was crucified there for our transgressions. The justice of God was poured out on the Son of God, so that we could have mercy if we'd call upon him and believe by faith and repent this morning. Has there ever been a shepherd like this? Psalm 23 is realized in Jesus Christ. It's found in him. Christ Jesus is my shepherd. I shall not want. You have something even sweeter in its fulfillment from what David found in Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd. Jesus Christ, the good shepherd, is mine. I am one with him. I abide. We are one. I shall not want. I think John 15 is the kind of a correlation of Psalm 23. I'm a vine, you're a branch. And there's this oneness and this beauty that we have. It's better than a shepherd and a sheep. It brings you even one step closer with a vine and a branch with Yahweh, the living God, Jesus Christ. One. Christ is my shepherd. Will you find in him your all in all? I have everything in Christ. What a shepherd. To live a life of complete trust and peace because he is my shepherd. He says, I have come that they might have life and they might have it more abundantly. I want you to let this fill your heart this morning. Do you see what is implied? The Lord is my shepherd. Because of that, I'll never want. I shall not want. He lays down his life for the sheep. He gives all that he is and all that he has to us day and night to fulfill this promise, to protect us, to give us his presence. I'll be with you always. You have the good shepherd. When a shepherd bought his sheep, he knew that was just the beginning. Keller said, when I first bought that first set of sheep, it finally hit me that they're mine. They're mine, but he knew all that took place to finish, to get them ready for slaughter. That parallel is not very good, sorry. Ours happens to be for blessing, eternal blessing. So he knew it was just the beginning. All the work that a shepherd had to do to bring them to fulfillment. So our shepherd will bring us home to the Father. And Jesus, he purchased us. And he'll do everything that we need as a good shepherd to bring us safely to our destination of eternal life with him forever. He will do everything necessary for that to happen. He will lose none of his sheep. Let that grab your heart. May we live into the fullness then of this psalm and its fulfillment in the Good Shepherd. And next week we're going to make some application then that I shall not want. And so I want you to go this week and I want you to get alone with the Lord and just let the truth that Yahweh is your shepherd, let it take hold and let it flourish. And just, oh, blessed life, you know, he leadeth me. I come under the hand of the good shepherd. And I just, man, we're such a complaining people in America. And the beauty of what the church should be, to have a blessed shepherd like this, I just want you to come under this. And I want the fruit of it to just flow. And we will just keep opening up week after week of the blessings that you have because Yahweh is your shepherd. Jesus Christ is the good shepherd for you. Amen. Let's pray. Oh, Father, I thank you for the beauty of this reality that you're our shepherd. God, you lead and you guide me into every place, every season, every path. And you never leave me. As a shepherd, you don't flee when the wolf comes. You're not a hireling. You gave your life for us. Oh, God, I thank you, Jesus Christ, for the shepherd that you are to each and every soul. Father, I thank you that you're a vine dresser and you prune branches. You cut off just the right things so that we might bear more fruit. God, let us come under the beauty of a Father who prunes branches and a Christ who's a vine that gives us all of our life and sustenance. God, let us find that blessed sweetness of dwelling as your sheep under your hand. We are so safe. We are so safe. God, let fears be just driven out from every heart. Lord, those who just sit here discontent with their lot in life, God, they're discontent with the good shepherd. They're discontent with what you're doing. Lord, there's times where all we can see is the darkness of what you're doing. Oh, give us the blessed trust of the good shepherd who is working everything for our good and your glory. God, please let us behold that. Let us know the good shepherd. Let us be drawing near and growing and communing and fellowshipping and learning in this word about the good shepherd. And Lord, I pray that we will trust you completely and utterly and unconditionally as the sheep of your pasture. God, I thank you for this. In the name of Jesus, I do pray. Amen.